Good afternoon. I'm John Levi, and as I said at lunch, it's my distinct privilege to serve as the 10th chairman of the board of the Legal Services Corporation. And thank you for joining us this afternoon for this important forum on a core American value, access to justice. We're privileged to be here at the United States Courthouse for the District of Utah, and particularly want to thank the court for giving us this beautiful facility. We're also grateful that Utah's distinguished Chief Justice, Matthew Durrant, has taken time from his busy schedule to join us at lunch and speak with us this afternoon. Today's program also includes two special panels. The first features four leaders of LSC from the statewide legal services program who will discuss how they collaborate across the Mountain States region. And LSC's outstanding, longest-serving president, Jim Sandman, will moderate. The second panel focuses on legal aid and Native American communities, bringing together leaders of the Native American legal community and legal aid providers who work with them. LSC board member Gloria Valencia Weber, herself an expert on these issues, will moderate. But we gather here today at a particularly busy time for LSC. Just ask the staff that you will really understand. But 2 weeks ago, LSC awarded technology initiative grants to 30 legal services organizations. The TIG program funds technology projects, providing greater access to high-quality legal assistance and information for low-income Americans. And it's done that since 2000, making 720 grants totaling more than $65 million over that period. So Utah Legal Services has received more than a dozen of these grants over the years, the latest a $300,000 grant last year to use artificial intelligence in the system guiding users seeking legal help through the process of identifying their legal issues and matching them with appropriate resources. Other TIG funding helped Utah Legal Services build new modules to collect and organize client data, capture case activities and other important functions, expand its domestic leading library so it can more effectively be used by program staff and volunteer attorneys, and creating automated documents for use in Social Security disability matters. A few weeks ago on Capitol Hill, the LSC released its report of the disaster task force. Since 2014, there have been more than 500 presidentially declared disasters, 8 of them here in Utah. Low-income families and individuals are typically the hardest hit by such disasters, and after they struggle to regain their lives, they frequently have pressing legal needs, such as replacing legal identification papers, applying for disaster benefits, dealing with insurance claims, preventing unlawful evictions and foreclosure, and combating contractor scams, just to mention a few. That task force was generously supported by Latham & Watkins, and its IFTU report, which executive summary, which is outside there for you to memorize, the rest of the report is online. And it recognizes that legal aid providers are key to addressing the legal issues that arise following a disaster and highlight concrete steps to build a systematic, coordinated, and sustainable approach to helping low-income families and individuals and communities prepare for before they have, respond to, and recover from the disaster. Events marking the release of this comprehensive report will be held again next month in New York and then again in December in New Orleans. Earlier this year, at events in Washington, Chicago, and Nashville, LSC released the report of another of its task forces, this one addressing the alarming legal implications of the nation's opioid crisis. And that crisis you know well here in Utah. Because Utah's rate of death from opioid overdoses is 15.5 per 100,000 people, and that's higher, unfortunately, than the national average of 14.6 deaths per 100,000. It's one of four states with the highest overdose death rate from abuse of prescription opioids. Well, our task force, supported by my firm, is comprised of leaders from legal and medical communities, government, and veterans, and social services organizations, made a series of significant recommendations on how LSC and the civil legal aid community can work with other stakeholders in the medical, judicial, law enforcement community to deal more effectively with this tragedy. Well, this report recognizes that civil legal aid providers are actually in a unique position to address these legal issues, facing low-income people with opioid use disorders, especially when they partner with healthcare providers and other social service law enforcement and judicial entities. That report is also out there on the desk for you to memorize. LSC does not appoint task forces or have them write a report to have those reports sit on shelves. And so we at LSC are creating ongoing working groups to follow and encourage progress on both of the report's recommendations. Then, on November 11th, the 100th anniversary of Veterans Day, LSC will continue another initiative by convening its second Veterans Day Summit, this time in New York City, to highlight the significance of civil legal aid to this underserved community. Despite efforts such as these and the vital work done by Utah Legal Services and every other LSC grantee across the country, we still have a long way to go to ensure equal access to justice for all. I think many of you in this room know, because you've read our justice gap studies and you're closely connected to the legal aid community, that nearly 59 million Americans qualify for LSC-funded civil legal assistance because they're living at 125% of the federal poverty guideline and below. And our justice gap study from 2017, found that an estimated 1 million civil legal problems brought to LSC's grantees by low-income Americans did not receive the legal assistance required to fully address their needs because of lack of resources. And earlier this year, LSC conducted a new intake census of all of its 132 grantees. And that suggested that the level of unmet need continues, unfortunately, unabated. This 2019 intake study focused on eligible clients who sought assistance for civil legal problems at LSC's grantees during a four-week period this past spring. It found that 42% of the legal problems presented received no service of any kind, and only 27% of the eligible problems were in fact fully served, again, because of lack of resources. Well, the consequences of forcing so many low-income folks to navigate our civil legal system on their own presents extremely serious consequences. The studies show that represented parties have substantially higher success rates than those who are unrepresented. In Virginia, for example, win rates for represented defendants are 10 times those of unrepresented defendants in debt collection cases. When tenants represent themselves, and we hear these reports, we've received these reports from so many states and cities, if they're not represented in housing court, they're evicted nearly 50% of the time. If they're represented, then they stay in their homes 90% of the time. Based on national statistics, there's only one legal aid lawyer for every approximately 10,000 client-eligible individuals to serve their civil legal needs. So is it any wonder that we're seeing statistics like these? Simply put, our grantees need more money. And although Congress actually increased LSC funding in 2019 to $415 million, that figure is still below the $420 million that was appropriated nearly a decade ago in 2010, and less than half in what today's dollars would be the $880 million appropriated just 4 years after LSC's founding in the 1970s, when only 12% of then smaller population qualified for LSC-funded legal assistance. Even if Congress met LSC's fiscal year 2020 budget request for $593 million, it would still be less in inflation-adjusted dollars than it was during many years of the Reagan administration. And as we meet today, we know that the House has approved a budget of $550 million for legal services, but the Senate is at $425 million, and so if it ever gets to conference, they'll have to sort it out. And so that looks like we'll get an increase, but it's, you know, folks, we're kidding ourselves. We're just leaving so many people out on the outside of our justice system looking in. And the chronic underfunding of civil legal aid is much more than just another Washington battle over discretionary spending. I don't think, and I bet you don't either, that there should be anything discretionary about equal access to justice. It's not charity. Equal access is essential to justice, as the late Edmund Scalia so powerfully observed at LSC's 40th anniversary just a few years ago. Many of us in this room were privileged to hear him that day, and I can still hear and sort of see the justice. I'll try to do justice to him. He said, "The ideal, the American ideal, is not for some justice. It is, as the Pledge of Allegiance says, liberty and justice for all. Or as the Supreme Court judgment has it, equal justice." I've always thought that somewhat productive. Can there be justice if it's not equal? Can there be a just society when some do not have justice? Equality, equal treatment, is perhaps the most fundamental element of justice, unquote. Well, our newly constituted LSC board, like the ones that preceded it, is committed to doing what it can to call attention to the crisis in civil legal aid and the threat that it poses now to our democracy. Thank you very much, and it's now my privilege to introduce my colleague on the LSC board. Almost a decade he's had to put up with me, Vic Maddox from Kentucky. Vic is at the firm of Foltz, Maddox, and Dickens. He is a graduate of the Ohio University and Indiana University. He worked for the Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell. Here, I guess.
A long time ago.
Yes, quite a while ago.
When Senator McConnell was a freshman senator.
There you go. Well, as a freshman senator, you gave him great advice in the Judiciary Committee on very important matters, and but probably something you don't know. This guy is an accomplished saxophonist, and by God, he's going to bring his saxophone to one of these meetings.
Actually, I did have the privilege of playing with my saxophone quartet at the Equal Justice Conference in Louisville earlier this year. Thank you, Don Saunders. It was a packed house of about 400 people, I think, at the reception. So, and it is my privilege today to introduce our first speaker, Utah Supreme Court Chief Justice Matthew Durrant. Chief Justice Durrant has served as Chief Justice on the Utah Supreme Court since 2012 and has been a justice on the court since 2000. He was the founding chair of the court's professionalism committee, where he was tasked with revising the Code of Judicial Conduct. He not only represented the court as a member of the Utah Judicial Council, but also chaired the Judicial Council's Technology Committee. Moreover, Chief Justice Durrant has taken part in several legal aid initiatives sponsored by the court, such as the Utah Work Group on regulatory reform. The coalition between the Utah Supreme Court and the Utah Bar Association designed to address the national justice gap by piloting and implementing creative solutions on the state level. Before his appointment to the Utah Supreme Court, Chief Justice Durrant served on the bench of Utah's 3rd District Court for more than 3 years. He also clerked for Judge Monroe McKay of the United States Court of Appeals for the 10th Circuit. And later worked for the Salt Lake City law firm of Parr Brown, where he later became a member and shareholder. Outside the courthouse, Chief Justice Durrant is taught as an adjunct professor at the J. Reuben Clark Law School at Brigham Young University, where he also earned his BA degree. He earned his JD degree from Harvard Law School. Now, let me just say on a personal note, before that, he earned his high school baccalaureate degree from Seneca High School in Louisville, Kentucky, which is about 5 miles from where I currently live, and where I play as a kid on the school grounds because my grandmother lived 2 blocks away. So it's my privilege today to introduce Utah's great Chief Justice, Matthew Durrant.
I'd like to thank Victor for that kind introduction. I'm very privileged to be able to address this group, because this group is a group of people dedicated to doing the kinds of things to protect the most vulnerable in our communities, the kinds of things we all feel guilty that we don't do more of. It's inspirational to be with this group, and I found Chairman Levy's remarks just so really profound and inspirational. So he set the perfect tone. I hope I don't detract too much from that. We are honored that you would come to Utah. We realize you're legally obligated to do that every 20 years or so. But we kind of feel like you probably would have come even if you were not under that obligation. And it's wonderful to have you here. I hope you have a great experience here. I hope you've competently been good hosts. I hope we have been. Well, I've been asked to address some of the different programs, the initiatives in Utah that we've conducted or are in the process of implementing, to try to address this access to justice gap. This is a gap that you are much more aware of, being on the front lines. Having dedicated much, or I'm sure in some cases all of your professional lives, to trying to meet the needs of low-income individuals. So I know I'm very much preaching to the choir on all this, but I did find the results of the 2017 study fascinating. I was interested to learn about the 2019 study. As I read those results, that's 2017, it was 86% of those who were eligible and sought assistance were unable to receive assistance. It sounds like that may have improved a little bit, with 26% in 2019 receiving assistance. And of course, as you all well know, that's just the tip of the iceberg. That's the people who are aware that they might have a claim, that they might be in need of some kind of legal assistance. So when you start to think about all the people who face these everyday problems, now every lawsuit matters, and yes, the big complex commercial lawsuits, the high publicity lawsuits, that all matters, that's important. But what really matters to most Americans are all these legal problems, like the list described by Chairman Levy, the problems that seem interwoven into our lives, all of our lives, certainly in the lives of middle-income earners, and absolutely in the lives of low-income individuals. For them, these small things, all the apply to this or deal with this landlord problem or this creditor problem or disability benefits. And Chairman Levy spoke of it so eloquently. But yes, those are the problems that are interwoven into their lives. And for them, they are especially consequential because there are so few places to turn. Now, the obvious one is the legal service corporation funded organizations and other legal aid organizations. And you do such extraordinary work and affect so many lives in so many profound ways. As Chairman Levy indicated, it's the best we can do, but we're addressing such a small fraction of all of the legal needs out there. And as my former colleague, Christine Durham, so eloquently put it, and as our report has indicated, the report she referenced, and I assume most of you were at the luncheon, I'll touch on some of the things she said, but I'll try not to bore you with too much detail. I understand this is being streamed as well, so I'll touch on some of the things she said. We can't volunteer our way out of the problem. Lawyers, in my experience, tend to be extremely public-minded. They want to volunteer. Their time is valuable, but they still give it, in so many cases, freely. But that's just not enough. We need, as a judiciary, to make structural changes, to do our part in this grand effort. I should mention that Christine Durham was my predecessor as Chief Justice, and it is said of her that she is the best Chief Justice in Utah's history. And it's said of me that I am one of the Chief Justices in Utah. If I was, of course, distressed that I would have to follow her, but still, it's an honor for me. I'm guessing many of you are familiar with this quote, but Nelson Mandela said that you should judge a nation not by how it treats its highest citizens, as he put it, but how it treats its lowest citizens. So that raises a question, how are we doing that as a nation? The answer for people in this room is you're doing great. You're dedicating yourselves and your time to this important cause. But as for the rest of the nation, not so good. We know from the 2017 World Justice Center study that the United States ranks 99th out of 126 countries. This great nation, with all of its resources and all of its wealth, is tied for 99. To me, that is nothing short of shameful. This is not, as Chairman Levy put it, should not be a discretionary budget matter. This is another animal altogether. This is providing assistance to especially our lower income citizens of the most critical services in their lives. It's the very heart. Providing access to justice should be at the very heart of our country's greatness. Now, let me touch first of all in terms of the programs that we're working on, just to give you a sense of it. And this will be albeit a high level of generality. But one of the things we've done that I'm proud of and hopeful for is something we call a licensed paralegal professional. Okay, this is, we are the second state, really, Washington laid out on this, the second state to initiate this kind of a program. But other states are considering it, and I think you'll start to hear more and more about it. It's a new profession, this LPP. Think physician's assistant. Okay, they're not paralegals, although they must have some paralegal experience to qualify. But these are individuals who pass a rigorous one-year curriculum in their chosen area. And then following that, they are tested in that area, and should they be certified, they are then sworn in as licensed paralegal professionals. We had our first cohort sworn in just last week. It's small to begin with, but I am confident this will snowball as more and more people learn about this opportunity. Now, what does it matter in terms of access to justice? These individuals will be able to practice law. They'll be able to perform services that, to this point in Utah, only lawyers could provide. And they will do it in three areas of, I think, special interest to this group. Landlord-tenant law. Hopefully we can get them representing some of these tenants facing eviction. Debt collection. And family law. Now, they cannot do everything a lawyer can do. As of now, they can't go to court. Their practice is circumscribed in certain ways. But still, in most cases, virtually all cases in these categories, they will be able to provide much, if not all, of the assistance that a client would require to help them and guide these clients through the process and in addressing their needs. Now, the idea is that these individuals will be able to provide legal services at a lower cost. Because the unmet need for lawyers is, again, as Chairman Levy so well described it, is pressing. I know that in our district that includes this area, our third district in Utah, in family law and other civil cases, in 93% of those cases, at least one side is unrepresented throughout the proceeding, so that they are at a severe disadvantage. We hope that this new profession will help to address that disadvantage, at least in some measure. So I have high hopes for that. Our second program is online dispute resolution. The courts are way behind the private sector in this. eBay resolves literally hundreds of millions of cases on market disputes. And more people are turning to private organizations as opposed to the courts, but it's only the courts that can ensure justice. We have three pilot projects going in three large, what we call justice courts. Any small claims matter, I forget what our maximum is right now, it's like $7,500. So any case worth, or maybe it's $11,000, under that amount can be resolved wholly online. Okay, so we call this a pajama court. You can interact with the other party asynchronously. So in other words, you can ask maybe a question in interrogatory in the morning, that party can answer it when he or she gets home at night. Same with the exchange of documents. You can enter into settlements discussions all online. You more than any other group know how disruptive it can be for some of the people you serve to take a day off of work to go to court. This eliminates that. This makes it convenient. If they can reach a settlement, the facilitator helps them prepare a settlement document. If they can't reach a settlement, then the facilitator helps them prepare a document describing the issues and the evidence to be presented to a judge who can interact with them and resolve this matter, again, online. Either party at any point, should they wish to go to a physical courthouse and present their case to a judge personally, they're also free to do that. So far, we've seen great success with these pilots. We're seeing a lot more engagement on the part of defendants, fewer defaults. We're seeing more settlements. We're even seeing more judgments. So that's just the second of our efforts that I'll describe to try to address this access to the justice gap. Finally, And this is what my colleague, Justice Durham, addressed at lunch. So again, I won't spend a lot of time on this, but I'll just touch on a few of the high points of our regulatory reform effort. In late 2018, bar leadership requested that our Supreme Court form a work group to consider ways in which we can, in which the regulatory structure for the provision of legal services and the regulation of lawyers can be restructured or optimized in a way so as to decrease or increase the affordability of legal services and also increase access to justice. So that group, which included academics and national, international experts and other stakeholders, recently issued a report, which is publicly available, in which they made a number of recommendations, and Justice Durham summarized them beautifully and in detail. But just to recap them briefly, they have proposed, and our Supreme Court has adopted these recommendations, and we have created a new committee to work out the details of these with respect to these issues and also to implement the recommendations. But they propose a two-track process, a concurrent two-track process. As to the first track, the committee recommends substantial loosening, or even in some cases, an elimination of many of the rules that presently, let me say it another way. A substantial loosening of rules with respect to fee arrangements. So this could potentially allow for fee sharing. It could allow for referral fees, presently restricted in Utah. The recommendations would allow for the potential elimination of Rule 5.4, which prohibits non-lawyer ownership interest in law firms. The idea is we want to open up the entities that provide legal services to additional investment. We'd like to open up also our legal market to additional innovation. So that's on the one side. We'd also relax rules relative to lawyer advertising and solicitation. So this is all, of course, very new, and it's natural to be nervous about this. If you're a lawyer, you have an established practice. And as we work through this, we may adopt some of these and not others. But the way we have it structured now seems to, I think many of the ways in which we've structured legal practice, the regulation of legal practice were motivated and remain motivated by the right kinds of motives, that is to protect the public and to ensure the highest ethical standards for lawyers. But sadly, that notwithstanding, there is a strong, I think, protectionist smell to the way we do it right now. And to me, it is, as has been described, this access to justice gap is at crisis levels. And the way we are presently structured as lawyers, they simply don't work. We need to find more ways to give legal services to people who need them. We need to continue to maintain the same high ethical standards. We need to ensure that the consumers are protected, but most of those consumers can't even get close to a provider of legal services. There's a bigger, much bigger problem for us right now. So that's one aspect of this. I see that John Lund's here. He's one of our co-chairs, and I think he's done extraordinary work in leading out on this effort. It's been critical in Utah that the bar has been the initiator and has been so active. And they remain active on our committee. We have the
soon to be, or the incoming bar president on our committee right now. So that's one track. The second track involves trying to generate innovation and investment in entities that provide legal services. So you heard Christine refer to this legal sandbox. What we'd like to see, we'd like to create an environment where entrepreneurs, lawyers, non-lawyers, and others who would propose legal products or mechanisms, models for the delivery of legal services, we want to welcome them into Utah. There's a lot of disruption going on already. I think an excellent question was asked at our luncheon on this topic. Much of this might happen whether we like it or not. But we want to create an environment where we can say to these would-be entrepreneurs or innovators, come to Utah, make your pitch to this new regulatory body that we will create. Testing your product may require that we waive some of our rules. We'll do that if we have adequate assurances that the public will be protected. We want you to come. We want you to put your money to work in figuring out how we can provide these critical legal services to those who are so much in need. The middle class, certainly, and most importantly, to the lower income citizens. So we don't know how this is going to go. It's a blank slate. But what we have now is not working. So many people, more and more people, do not have legal representation. In some cases, I think as President Sandman told me, I relayed a quote from another Chief Justice. She thinks a lot of these unpaid or these unrepresented litigants that we see in our courtrooms are the result of the Judge Judy phenomenon. They see how it happens on TV and they come in thinking it's going to be every bit that casual, and often they're surprised by what they find. So there's an element of DIY, a do-it-yourself in this, DIY, I guess, do-it-yourself in this unlitigated litigant phenomenon, but largely, far and away, the reason that people don't have lawyers is they can't afford lawyers. So we either need to find a way to get lawyer services, or these legal, licensed paralegal professional services to them, or make the courts more accessible, give them the forms they need. Or we need to also structure the practice of law in such a way that people can develop the kinds of products that might be useful to them. So I've gone on long enough. Those are some of our efforts. I would like to just, again, thank you for you and your organizations and those people who populate your different funded organizations. You are the real boots on the ground soldiers in this effort, doing, I think, the most important work that can be done by a lawyer today in our country. So I want to thank you for your service. Thank you.